The Indian River Lagoon stretches through five coastal counties and is the heart of the Treasure Coast. It is home to more than 3,000 species of plants and animals, including 35 listed on the threatened or endangered list, more than any other water body in North America. But over the last 100 years, the impacts of more than 1.6 million people living along this estuary has increased the amount of freshwater runoff and nutrients flowing into this fragile ecosystem. Through this six-part series, we'll hear from scientists, researchers, and government officials who will provide a better understanding of the history of the lagoon, the problems impacting it, and offer solutions to improve the water quality along the Indian River Lagoon and its tributaries. So dive in as we listen to the water.
All right, now we're on. Good evening, and welcome to another in our lecture series of Listen to the Waters. Tonight we have several speakers also, and our first speaker is State Representative Gayle Harrell. And it's my pleasure to introduce her. She will be sharing some information about Legacy Florida, a bill she was recently instrumental in passing in the Florida legislature. Legacy Florida will be a game changer in that it will provide a long-term dedicated funding source to stop the releases from Lake Okeechobee and restore Everglades, Lake Okeechobee, St. Lucie River, and Caloosahatchee River. Representative Gayle Harrell was first elected to the Florida House of Representatives in 2000. She's currently chair of the Children, Families, and Senior Subcommittee, and is a sitting member of the Health and Human Services Committee, the Health and Human Services Appropriations Subcommittee, and in her spare time, also in the Criminal Justice Subcommittee. With 14 years of service in the Florida House, Representative Harrell is a leader in setting policy for the state and has a long history of working for our rivers and our estuaries. At the state level, she worked to fund over $2.4 billion for the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan, $200 million for the Lake Okeechobee Restoration. She supported the Northern Everglades and Estuaries Protection Program, which expanded the Lake Okeechobee Protection Act to include the Caloosahatchee and St. Lucie Rivers and Estuaries. She supported the Indian River Lagoon South Restoration Project, consisting of multiple water storage and water treatment projects. She's worked to fund the recommendations of the Senate Select Committee on the Indian River Lagoon and Lake Okeechobee Basin, and she fought for funding of Florida Forever since she was first elected in 2000. Gayle has also advocated for our estuaries on the federal level, traveling to Washington, D.C. on many occasions to meet directly with our congressional delegation and influential members of environmental committees. She has sponsored many memorials or messages to Congress, urging them to authorize the next phase of Everglades restoration. Each of these memorials represents the voice of the people of the state speaking directly to Congress and the president to send a strong message to fund the Everglades restoration program. Gayle has worked with our local county commissions, city commissions and councils, and the St. Lucie River Issues Team. She's worked diligently to secure over $32 million for local St. Lucie Issue Team projects, $100 million for the C-44 Canal Project, $3 million for the Danforth Creek Stormwater Project, $30,000 for water testing in the St. Lucie Estuary, $3 million to control agricultural runoff in the Okeechobee, Caloosahatchee, and St. Lucie River watersheds, as well as funding for our local beaches and inlets. Ms. Harrell has been married to Dr. James Harrell, who's here tonight, for 51 years. They have four children and eight grandchildren, and she is an active member of the First Presbyterian Church in Stuart. So will you join me, please, in welcoming Representative Gayle Harrell. I don't know if you have any time left, Representative.
They promised me 5 minutes, and he used it all up. Well, first I want to thank St. Lucie County for doing this. This is an amazing series that they have put together. And it's really, to me, one of the key things to do is to really educate our people about what is going on and what we as citizens can do to really help our rivers, our estuaries, and the Indian River Lagoon. This is our way of life here. This is who we are. Our natural resources really define us, and working to restore the Everglades, to protect our rivers, to save the Indian River Lagoon has been key to what I've really been involved in. And one of the game-changing pieces of legislation that really came out of this whole area, and probably with the passage of Amendment 1, we really were able to find the resources to do this. And using Amendment 1 dollars, we were able to pass Legacy Florida. It took me 2 years of working very closely. We have the Audubon here today, and I just want to say thank you to them and the Nature Conservancy and the Everglades Foundation, because they were key to helping with moving that legislation forward. We really took some time to craft it very, very carefully to make sure that we would have that dedicated funding source in order to be able to have money year after year. I've lived on the Treasure Coast since 1971. I live on the North Fork of the St. Lucie. And I've seen what has happened. My children, my grandchildren have seen what is happening to our rivers. And it is, in order to really address the situation, we really need long-term funding. Every year, you fight again and again, whether it is the C-44 canal, the St. Lucie River Issues Team money, whatever, you're fighting every year to get the dollars. If you have a dedicated funding source, at that point, you can work on continuing the projects year after year. You know they're going to get done. You know they're going to be there. You can also start new projects, and you can do long-term projects. And importantly, you can then push the federal government and say to them, where's your money? As you know, and from part of the education you've been receiving, in 2000, we passed the Comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan. That's federal legislation that says that we are going to, the state and the federal government, as 50-50 partners, are going to restore the Everglades. The Everglades starts at Shingle Creek, up around Orlando. If you've been up there and you've gone to the MGM Grand, you know where Shingle Creek starts. This is a major, major problem that's 80 years in the making. The state's put about $2.4 billion into that plan of restoration. The feds have maybe put $1.2 billion. Legacy Florida gives us the ability to say to them, we have, and I'll kind of outline what it does for you. It puts 25%, a minimum of 25%, $200 million or more. We put $203 million in this year into comprehensive Everglades restoration with priority given to projects that will stop the releases from Lake Okeechobee. This is key. And when you divide that up, I have handouts over here if you want to pick up a handout, and what really gives you a good explanation of where the money goes is the little chart. The teacher in me comes out, you know, have to have my chart. $32 million goes into what's called the long-term strategies, and that happens until 2023. $32 million each and every year. And that is really to clean the water that is going to go into the Everglades. We have got to make sure that under federal court order, that water is below 10 units per billion in phosphorus in order to enter the Everglades. And that is a commitment we made in a settlement with the federal court with the Miccosukees and the Seminoles. $100 million goes into comprehensive Everglades restoration projects. These are things that are identified, part of SEP. You know, we've heard a little bit about SEP, I'm sure. And these are projects that are really either underway or currently in planning. Then we have, and it increases every year, the amount of money that goes in. This year, $31 million at least goes into additional projects. It gives us the ability to start new projects and to really look at what else needs to be done. Again, the priority is stopping the releases from Lake Okeechobee. So I'll leave this with you. You can get a copy over here. I don't want to take too much time, but as you think about how we move forward from here, Legacy Florida is a key component. It is something the state has made a solid commitment year after year, $4 billion over the next 20 years at a minimum is going into comprehensive Everglades restoration and with priority in stopping the releases from Lake Okeechobee. Thank you very much. I appreciate the time. And take your little handout home. We have some nice quotes from Eric. Let me see. We have Eric Draper from Audubon, Eric Eichenberg from Everglades Foundation, and a variety of others from Temperance Morgan from the Nature Conservancy. They all worked very closely with me in getting this passed, and I wanted to acknowledge them in particular. Thank you.
And Representative, I understand you are staying for the entire program, so if you have any questions for her afterwards, she will be available for that as well. All right, our main presenter is Duane E. Defreese, PhD. Dr. Defreese currently serves as the executive director of the newly formed Indian River Lagoon Council, a special district of the state of Florida, and a host for the Indian River Lagoon National Estuary Program. Duane serves as a governor-appointed board member of CareerSource Florida, Inc. He also serves as vice chair of Florida Ocean Alliance. His previous positions include senior science and sustainability consultant to HydroProtech LLC, courtesy professor status at Florida Institute of Technology and University of Central Florida, senior vice president for science and business development for Aquafiber Technologies Corporation, which patented processes and technologies to harvest naturally occurring algae and remove nutrients and other compounds that accumulate in surface waters and lead to eutrophication and pollution. Through an active public speaking schedule and community leadership, Duane is changing public perception about the value of ocean and coastal research and conservation. His numerous public presentations and workshops have a central message. Our oceans and coasts are an engine that drives the economy and quality of life of Florida and the nation. In the past 5 years, Duane has focused his public presentations on coastal adaptations to climate change and sea level rise, technologies to address eutrophication of surface waters, and integration of ecology and economics to enhance public awareness of the ocean and coastal economy, all challenges and opportunities for the 21st century. Duane received his Bachelor's of Science in Zoology from University of Rhode Island and his Master's and his PhD in Marine Biology from Florida Institute of Technology. Go Panthers. So help us bring forward Dr. Duane Defreese, PhD. Thank you. Another challenging introduction.
Good evening, everybody. I'm going to apologize straight off the bat. I've been fighting a terrible case of laryngitis. So the staff here got me some honey, some tea, and I'm ready to go. And we'll see if we can't tee up our presentation and get started here. Let's see where mine is. There we go. What I'd like to do today is give you an idea of where we are in the lagoon from the context of the entire lagoon. A year ago, I took over the executive directorship of the National Estuary Program, And we have very much been in two modes over this last 12 months. The beginning of a new special district of the state of Florida, which is a challenge to start a new special district, a reorganization of a 25-year-old national estuary program. And 90 days into my first year, we sought discharges out of Lake Okeechobee, and so we've been in almost an emergency mode ever since. So I want to give you a context of where I think we need to go from the standpoint of not just the environmental context of the lagoon, but also the human context. And I pulled some pictures, thanks to TC Palm, from here, and just imagine what it must have been like in the turn of the 17th century, the 18th century, or these pictures just from this local area, the 19th century, and what the perceptions of the lagoon were back in those days, and how impossible it really is to imagine what those individuals would think if they saw us here today with the kind of technologies that we have, with the growth that we've had as a state, and this tremendous just transformation of land and water. And so change is inevitable, but the future is really hard to foresee. And I'm an optimist. I think the future is very positive for us, but there's some work that needs to be done. And our perception of the state has changed in dramatic ways as well. And so if I am living here in St. Lucie County, I see the lagoon from this backyard perspective. I live in Indian Atlantic in Brevard. I see it, for the most part, in a Brevard perspective. But because I've had 40 years of running up and down this coast, I also see the lagoon in its entirety, and the state of Florida, because I ran an endangered lands program back in the heyday of Preservation 2000. I'm proud to say I've walked on a lot of land in the state of Florida, but our perceptions are important. And the way we see this system that is the state of Florida is important, not just today, but for the future. And so I show this only to let you know that we are in a changing ecosystem. It's changing socially, changing environmentally. Sea level rise has changed in the past. It's changing today. I'm glad we're all sitting here safe from what turned out to be a pretty devastating storm. But many of you down here in the southern region of the lagoon were spared quite a big hit. Looks a little worse in Brevard. But as I moved north over the last 2 weeks into northern Florida, our friends to the north were hit very seriously. And then as you go into South Carolina, North Carolina, Georgia area, it's catastrophic in some places. So perception of where we are in time and space is important. So today I'd like to do three things. Talk about the Indian River Lagoon from the standpoint of big stewardship. Talk about the lagoon from the standpoint of what we are trying to do in the National Estuary Program, which is really a scientific and social experiment on network governance, and I'll talk about that in a bit. And how do we best prepare for an uncertain future? And I will tell you, we best prepare by taking action now where we can to build resilience and adaptability and stability, both in our economic, our social, and environmental context. So what do we know about the lagoon? Number one is it's really complicated. It's a complex system. Three water bodies, Mosquito Lagoon, Banana River Lagoon, Indian River Lagoon, combining for 156 miles. But it's not just the biological diversity. It's not just the ecological integrity that makes us unique. But we're also unique in the standpoint of a lagoon crossing both the temperate and the subtropical climate zones, this mixing of species in the shallow, poorly flushed system. And it is a lagoon. By nature, lagoons are poorly flushed. And so up in Mosquito Lagoon, it's part of what makes Mosquito Lagoon unique. But we are also really unique in our human context. And I don't know that I appreciated it as much as I do now after 12 months of running up and down this coast as part of this reorganization, talking to 45 cities and 5 counties, you know, seeing the differences and the similarities between all of us as residents along the lagoon. It's like a string of pearls, every one of these towns and cities with unique attributes, but one commonality, and that is the connection to our water. And we have multiple agency oversights, and the most recent economic study has the value of the lagoon at $7.6 billion per year. But we have multiple stressors, and you'll be very thankful that I'm not going to go into all of them, but the biggest stressor, and this is an older map when I was working with myregion.org with seven counties, but it gives you the context of how we can grow so quickly, even with as much growth as we've seen in the last 50 years. So this is Central Florida over the next 25 to 30 years, where we may double our population. And think about the beginning of, you know, the Everglades up towards Orlando and the impacts that urbanization has yet to deliver to our changing landscape and our changing waterscape. We need to consider future growth in everything we do, because growth in Florida is inevitable, especially in December and January if you're in Michigan and New York, and you look down and we're in, you know, bathing suits sitting on beautiful beaches. So we have chronic issues and stressors. And so for the northern portion of the Indian River Lagoon and central portion, we think about those chronic issues probably most importantly. And so I want you to take a look at this watershed map. And I want you to take a look at this picture. This picture was just before, a few weeks to a month before the hurricane came through. We have been in a continuous bloom in the north and central portion of the lagoon literally since 2011. And this is a pyridinium bloom, one of our most recent, just up around Banana River and Mosquito Lagoon. And for many years, we thought we were actually doing quite well within the system. From 1986 to 2007, and this is data from the St. John's River Water Management District, we saw an increase in seagrasses. And there was many who thought, well, that's a good indicator of health, isn't it? But what reality shows us is that it's not only one indicator. You have to look at multiple indicators. It's not just one symptom. You need to look at multiple systems. And we had already seen catastrophic losses in commercial fisheries. Our oysters, clams, and crabs in Brevard County that had very robust commercial fisheries had all but collapsed by the late 80s. And these are harbingers of things that aren't right. And so thinking about a system and thinking about the challenges for scientists about what constitutes a healthy Indian River Lagoon, that is not an easy thing to do, because you have different spatial and temporal scales. Is it healthy today? You know, the water looked pretty good out the back when I came into St. Lucie, but I also know what your water can and should look like here. And so while you are sitting in what may be the breadbasket, the Noah's Ark, because you are lucky to be situated between a couple of inlets and you have the best water quality in the lagoon right now, doesn't mean it's where we want it to be. And in fact, in 2009, we had Tropical Storm Fay, which I believe, and I think many, was the beginning of the turning point for some of the symptoms we see in the north and central part of the lagoon, followed by two really strong cold systems in December, January of 09, 010, and then again in 010, 011. And in 2011, we had what is now called the super bloom. That bloom started as a green algae, a picocyanobacteria, tiny little green, and it literally transitioned into a whole series of blooms that continue to today with only a few months in 2015 of relief. So think about the chronic nature of central and northern Indian River Lagoon. And we have gone from green picocyanobacteria to the brown-tide Oreo umbra, which we first saw back in 2012, 2013. And I'll show you some pictures of its impact this year in 2016. And we're seeing this cycling that's almost like a churning of algal blooms, and with these blooms, we have seen a catastrophic loss of seagrasses, which we know to be an important habitat for our fisheries, stability in the benthic or the bottom sediments. And so that's the northern and central portion of the lagoon, and when these blooms collapse, like the Oreo umber bloom did in March, we can see catastrophic fish kills because of a loss of oxygen. This is right off of Cocoa Beach in Banana River Lagoon. You read a lot, heard about, in fact, this fish kill went international in the news. The fact is there's been approximately 30 additional small fish kills that have been reported since then, but they've been isolated in areas not near populations. And so we are not a healthy system. You may hear some people say that the storm flushed the system. It is not the case. We had some flushing, but we really didn't have much rain with this system. We had a lot of wind, and a fair amount of water moved around. But the fact is that this system is still vulnerable, still sick, and still very sensitive to any changes that might occur. And then, of course, we, you know, heard Representative Harrell's really good description about this, you know, watershed that runs all the way to Shingle Creek up in Orlando. And so imagine the challenge that a national estuary program has for a lagoon and an estuary when, in fact, our watershed, and you see to the left what our normal watershed is actually coupled with the Everglades watershed. And decisions about how you restore the southern lagoon is predetermined by these, you know, seasonal impacts of water discharges. What it shows me as a scientist, as a citizen, and should really show you as citizens, that we are one water system in Florida. Fact is, we have multiple estuaries, 9 with national designations, and we can't just fix one. That we need to look at water restoration, water protection, water stewardship throughout the peninsula, because this water, groundwater, surface water, is all connected. And land is connected to these surface waters. We're going to have to address this in a very comprehensive way with the very best scientists and science that we can bring to the table. And the list of challenges are many. On the left are the stressors. Some are easy and really expensive. Some, like global climate change, ocean acidification, which I believe we're already seeing some impacts in the lagoon, sea level rise, very difficult challenges at broad scales, but we need to understand our risks, understand the best available science, and then make decisions, both in policy and action, that will address as many of these as we can to formidably put ourselves in a better position to adapt and actually maintain our quality of life as we move forward as a society. And on the right, just a few examples of what happens from these stressors. So it's not just one, it's multiple stressors working simultaneously at different spatial and temporal scales. You know, I often tell my students, you know, think about what an ant sees walking across the putting green of a golf course versus what a giraffe might see. You know, that idea of perception is very, very important. And we need to think not just in the now, but in the future, understanding the past. So you saw this with Dr. Edie Witter's presentation. It's one of the best representations of all of the nutrient and freshwater impacts that impact an estuarine system. And we are getting sources from surface water, from groundwater. We are getting sources from inside the system, the legacy loads of 30, 40, 50 years of having changed the plumbing in Florida to discharge water and the pollutants and the grass clippings and the sediments to a surface water body near you. And so some of what we need to decide now, because today is the time that we make these decisions best, can't turn the clock back, can't change the kind of the sins and the decisions of the past, but we can surely make better decisions today using really good science and we have some of the best scientists in the world for water right here in Florida. But we need to look at every single one of these sources. I get asked a lot in Brevard County, where we have, I think, 5 dredging operations already underway or coming out of permit to become underway, with great support from the Florida legislature over the last 3 years. You know, why don't we just dredge, and then we'll see what happens? This is not a battle. This is actually a war that has to be waged on multiple fronts. Everywhere we can reduce nutrients at the source, we can and we should. Everywhere we can reduce in the system, we can and we should. And we'll move this step by step over the course of a number of years forward and hopefully get back to a threshold for a healthy lagoon. So where are the big problems on these nutrient sources? Well, this is the corner of my street. On about a half-inch rain, this is looking south in Indy Atlantic. You know, that drainage site is right on the corner of my yard. So anytime I or my neighbors would decide to fertilize, use pesticides, or use herbicides, and it rains within 24 hours, there's a pretty good chance it's going down that drain, and that drain is headed for surface water. And so we need to rethink the plumbing for stormwater, and we need to manage that plumbing better than we have. I don't need to remind you, because you lived through this year, how devastating the discharges from Lake Okeechobee can be. And in fact, that in itself is also a plumbing problem. So this is not a natural discharge. You know, we changed Lake Okeechobee, we changed the discharge, we managed the water flow. And so as we move forward with comprehensive Everglades restoration, the key is managing those waters to either drastically reduce or stop that freshwater discharge both east and west to our estuaries. I can tell you, if that water was perfectly clean at potable drinking water level, it would still be devastating to an estuary just because of the salinity shock and the duration that we turn this estuary into a freshwater body. So this is about water quality, but it's also about water, freshwater delivery. We have to address that, and we have to be cognizant of these challenges that Edie Witter told at the last presentation about the human health implications as well as environmental. We have septic issues, 300,000 of them all along the lagoon. Not all of them are failing, but we need to find the ones that are and address those issues. And we have primary sewer issues. The top right-hand picture is Orangeburg Pipe. And if your home was built right after World War II or up into the 70s, there's a good chance it may have Orangeburg, and there's a good chance it's leaking. So we have to look at all of these issues. And deferring maintenance is a decision that those of us who have boated before and been out to sea, you can only defer maintenance for so long, and then the ship starts to sink. So where are we with the Indian River Lagoon National Estuary Program? What we have created is a brand new template. And I want to show you where we are structurally, because it's one thing to reorganize a business. It's a whole nother thing to have a culture change in how you operate. And we will find out how well our culture has changed over this next year and two as we begin to implement the work of the NEP. But the idea is that network governance, when it works best, brings the private sector, the public sector, and the independent sector together. Use the best available knowledge to drive a consensus, community involvement, action, and then a constant relook at can you do it better, quicker, faster. So if you're working across a large area like the lagoon with multiple jurisdictions, we need to work together and recognize that not one individual, not one county, not one organization can do it all. We have to do it together as a community. And that is the very basis, the heart of what the National Estuary Program was initially designed to do. It's pretty unique to see a regulatory entity back in the day decide to create a program based on non-regulatory, consensus-building, community engagement. So we have 28 National Estuary Programs that work to build consensus, to restore the very best estuaries across the nation with national designations. And what's beautiful about this network is I can call any of those executive directors, including the three here in Florida, at Charlotte Harbor, Tampa Bay, Sarasota Bay, and say, how do you guys do it? You know, am I seeing this right? And so this is a rich network of knowledge, of scientists and citizen engagement. So our reorganization was driven by that 2011 bloom and a recognition back in 2013 among the counties that local government involvement had to be higher. Leadership at the local level had to be better. That all of the really good on-the-ground stuff happens usually right here at the city and at the county. And so as a result of those discussions, the IRL Council was formed February 2015 as a new special district of the state of Florida with no regulatory authority, no taxing authority. It's through a interlocal agreement to work together among a number of partners, and we were designated as the new host of the NEP program just in January, less than a year ago. These are the partners who now constitute the IRL Council Board of Directors. What is phenomenal about this decision-making change is not just that we have embraced and enlarged our stakeholder capacity, but we've also significantly increased local dollars to this program, where we have local cost share dollars for turnkey projects, and we are moving very rapidly to implement. In fact, beginning in the next couple of months, we're negotiating contracts now. This fiscal year, we will have 40 on-the-ground projects, most in restoration, a few in education and citizen outreach and engagement, and a couple in research. And we will continue that effort to apply those dollars effectively and efficiently with three goals, and they're simple. We want a healthy lagoon. We want healthy species in the lagoon. We want healthy human communities and economies along the lagoon, and we need to go find dollars. And you heard earlier the power and importance of recurring dollars. I can't stress that more. You can't do good science, good restoration, or good stewardship unless you have money at the table over multiple years. Trying to do that year to year is challenging and sometimes impossible if you're trying to support, for example, long-term monitoring, mapping, and modeling. So this is what we look like structurally. We have taken the NEP and we've built a coalition of a board of directors at the council level, a management board, a science, technology, engineering, and modeling advisory committee, and a citizens advisory committee, all advising the new council within the Sunshine. And then we have built a coalition and will continue to build a coalition between contributing scientists and engineers, citizen ambassadors, and I want to just share with you something I think is exciting, and as far as I know, novel within the NEP program. We have created an Indian River Lagoon innovator and investor network. Our first partner to the table was Port Canaveral with a check for $100,000 to do citizen engagement and education. Our second partner to the table is Harris Corporation, who is working not only to take their 6,000 employees in Brevard County, engage them in Indian River Lagoon volunteerism, but they are also working directly with me to look at innovation in remote sensing and water quality technologies so we can look at monitoring in a 21st century way. Super exciting for me. And then citizen ambassadors, which are all of you. We are going to be taking the Citizen Advisory Committee local. So we will be coming to each of the counties to talk to the citizens on a regular basis. And I'm not going to go into this just to show you the breadth of the individuals representing the five counties in each of these areas of the enterprise. We have 22 research and science organizations now, each represented by an individual representative, and they collectively, if you look at that whole community, it's well over 100 scientists and engineers. and we'll be working with them to create our new comprehensive conservation and management plan. And we have 4 to 5 citizen representatives in each of the counties who will serve as our ambassadors to reach back into the county so we hear from you on a regular basis. This isn't my program. It's not a federal program. It's your program. Our job is to help you get this lagoon healthy. And we do this through a comprehensive conservation management plan approach. The last time ours was updated is 2008. The new plan will not look anything like the old plan. The new plan will be actionable. It is going to be very much like the Everglades comprehensive plan, where it is project-driven. We have already begun the beginning discussions of the science of this. We will be easy a year to 18 months in this activity, because a comprehensive plan is a big plan for an NEP, 22 to 25 action plan items. And so we have been really encouraged. I spent a couple hours with staff here today, because the local governments and communities are already building the action items within the counties and the cities to begin to resolve those issues that they need to address. So you think about 45 cities, 6 counties. 3 of those counties are moving sales tax referenda. This just happens to be Brevard, which, if passed, will generate $300 million a year, specifically for Indian River Lagoon restoration. St. Lucie County has a referendum on the ballot with projects that will support the lagoon. And so investing in change, investing in infrastructure upgrades, I think is a good way to move forward, and I'll show you all of the aspects of how we can change through a call to action at individual, community, state, and federal levels. So I see this as the R's, and in fact, this was first adopted in Brevard County with 4 R's. And their plan is, what do you need to remove? What do you need to reduce? What do you need to restore? How do we respond to improve knowledge and information as it comes to us? I've added a few R's, and so I'm going to go through these quickly. First, we need to reduce nutrient pollutant loading everywhere and anytime we can. So if you are a riverfront homeowner and you still have a perfect lawn on your bulkheaded backyard, you need to begin to rethink what that means. And can you do it better? And it may be as simple as reducing the amount of fertilizer, but it could be swales, it could be living shorelines, it could be stopping fertilization and using a different kind of landscape. At the community levels, this is going to be looking at stormwater, looking at groundwater, looking at all of our source loads, reducing everywhere we can, and every project is going to be progress. We need to rethink our water relationship, and I show this for a couple reasons. You can see the cyanobacterial plumes, but I've seen this with the blooms in Brevard as well. You know, nutrients, this land-to-water connection can generate nutrients that help fuel blooms along shorelines. And so this idea that your backyard may not contribute, may not help, you know, fuel a bloom is just, you know, nutrients are like food to algae, nitrogen in particular, but phosphorus also. So anywhere we can reduce, we should. We need to reduce the high volume freshwater flows. It's not natural. So having a giant slug of water come for a long period of time into a brackish water system, at the very least, disrupts the system in a natural, healthy world. But when you have a system that is already stressed and you have these discharges lasting for a long period of time, estuaries simply can't handle those long-duration, high-intensity loads. We need to reduce those where we can. And, of course, Lake Okeechobee discharges are critical to the future of the Southern Lagoon and its health. We need to remove muck. And it's not just muck. Muck is that legacy load generated over many years inside the system. I can tell you that we are working very hard in a number of projects to dredge, but we continue to push grass and grass clippings down almost every stormwater conveyance in the state of Florida. We need to rethink how we handle, you know, grass on lawns. And I challenge you all over the next week, every time you see a landscaper, you know, on a property, see where they blow the grass on the sidewalk or on the edging. It's always out into the road. And if you're on Route 1 or A1A, that's all heading to a storm drain and heading to become muck somewhere. Muck is a challenge because it's thick, it's gooey. Seagrass doesn't like to live in it, but it's also super high in nutrients. And all of the scientific evidence suggests that a lot of our blooms are being driven by nutrients already in the system. By the way, we need to remove impediments, you know, to permitting and impediments to water flow as well. This is a great diagram that was done by Dr. John Treffery at Florida Institute of Technology. And if you didn't believe that muck is a relatively recent human occurrence, then this core sample from the Indian River Lagoon proves differently. You can see pre-1950, that nice kind of medium to coarse sand bottom. After 1950, when all of a sudden America fell in love with the lawn, and you can see as we've grown, we have seen accumulations of muck that in some cases are several meters deep in some canals through the system, all loaded with nutrients. We need to restore everywhere we can. And that restoration starts with getting the water right. But I'm really happy to announce my staff was out on the water in the north end of the lagoon last week, and those oyster beds that have been planted by Brevard Zoo, Marine Discovery Center, and others are doing quite well in Mosquito Lagoon. Growth may have been, you know, hampered a little bit in some cases. You know, some of that storm did a little damage, but these organisms are resilient if we can get them back, and they are filter feeders. And so both clams, oysters, and many of the filter feeders, we're gonna have to restore those. I never thought I'd ever say this, but we're gonna have to restore seagrasses as well, which may include planting seagrasses and figuring out how to do that better in order to jumpstart this system. Responding, we have some members of Harbor Branch here. This is their, Lobo platform, you know, at the top picture, Edie Witters, Orca, Kilroy on the bottom. We need to look at integrated observing systems throughout the lagoon that give us real-time data at the levels we need to make good decisions. We've got a lot of people doing great work out there. We have some work to do to better share it, to better showcase this to you as citizens so you can find out what's going on. But I can tell you that I use both of these systems during the brown tide bloom. And every morning before I even cracked that coffee cup, I was online looking at water quality from both of these organizations. It's important. Yes, it's expensive. But it's the only way we can track what I call the cash flow of the lagoon. And that is, how is the water looking, not just today, not just tomorrow, but over long-term trends and spatial scales. There's incredible new technology on the way here. And then we need to build our infrastructure. And this isn't just about water quality. This is about 21st century communities, you know, updating their infrastructure for the people who are yet to come and for the communities that we want to be. Vibrant, healthy, economically diverse. You can't get there if your wastewater system is not working. Try buying a house in Flint, Michigan, or selling a house in Flint, Michigan. The fact is, nobody's going to Flint, Michigan right now because of the devastation of that water quality problem. And I can tell you from the tourist industry, what we've just gone through in water quality along the lagoon wasn't just national news, it was international news, and it impacted tourism statewide because the general public does not differentiate St. Lucie County and Martin County from Brevard County. They see green water, they see brown water, they see dead fish. You know, they take their discretionary cash somewhere else. And lastly, we need to report to you our progress, our opportunities, our ideas. And besides reporting to you, we need to listen to you as citizens, as stakeholders, as investors in this, you know, connection that makes us all neighbors, the Indian River Lagoon. And so the call to action is really investing in the Indian River Lagoon, but it's more than that. It's investing in the quality of life in our communities, because they are all interrelated. You can't have just good water quality and not think about transportation and schools and safety. They are all integrated in what makes super great coastal communities. And I've had the luxury and the benefit of living in some really good ones, including one I'm living in now. And I feel like I'm kind of a son of all of your communities now, trying to get to all 45. But this is what we're fighting for. $7.6 billion a year along the lagoon. In fact, tomorrow I'm with Department of Economic Opportunity to talk about a possible proposal for the Florida Oceanographic Association. And what we're looking at is, you know, how much is that economy worth in the state of Florida? And so Florida Oceanographic Alliance, I'm sorry, I misspoke that. Florida Oceanographic Alliance, and I serve on their board, has looked at economic development in that ocean and coastal industry cluster. And I think many of you will be surprised how big it really is. It's not one cluster, it's multiple clusters. It's ports, it's tourism, it's beach, you know, development, it's navigational aids, it's the guys building boats and women building boats. $583 billion a year. Clearly one of the biggest industry drivers within the state of Florida. And so I want to leave you with a vision. I have asked this question almost everywhere I go for the last 12 months I took this job. What is your vision in St. Lucie? What is your vision in Fort Pierce? What is your vision for South Florida? And very often, excuse me, I get this. My vision is fix the lagoon. I hate to tell you, this is not a vision. It may be an action, but it is not the vision that I see and that I think we should have. The vision really is that first we take action to fix the impacts that we know we're making that are impacting this system. And we think about a vision that isn't about fixing a problem, it's about the future, the preferred future of an Indian River Lagoon, and in fact, all of the waters of the state of Florida. So I will share with you a blue sky dream that was shared with me by a very good friend, Dick Nunes, who was an executive at the Walt Disney Company and also chairman of the board, now retired. And I've had the privilege of knowing Dick both as a friend and a mentor for a long time. And he said, Duane, he said, imagine if we took our technological knowledge, the fact that we're a peninsula in Florida, and we thought big, a blue sky dream for Florida, that we are a global leader in clean water technology. But our aspirational vision is that we are the first clean water state in the nation. You know, we've done that before. We did it with space and aviation. We're actually in the second chapter of that now with Blue Origin and SpaceX and commercial space flight, which I'm seeing, you know, come out of the ground in Brevard County. All the talent is here, the resources is here. We do not need to look somewhere else to fix these problems. We can and should fix our own problems using the best business, the best available science, the best available technology. We create the jobs, create the technology, clean our water, become the first clean water state in the nation, and then we export both the knowledge and the technology to the rest of the nation and the world. Now that is a vision. So we are all neighbors. We can't do this alone. The Indian River Lagoon National Estuary Program is really your program. So I leave you with one last thought, that if we think as one lagoon, we think as one community, and we think and speak with one voice, and that is clean water is an imperative, social, economic, and environmental imperative for the state of Florida, we will get there. And so I look forward to working with you, the citizens of not just this county, but the state of Florida, to make sure that the Indian River Lagoon becomes the healthy lagoon we hope it is. So thank you.